الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم أما بعد قال عز وجل بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم والذين آمنوا أشد حبا لله إلى آخره فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في حديث صحيح ذاق طعم الإيمان من رضي بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم رسوله Believing brothers and sisters, there was a tabi'i who was a student of Hassan al-Basri. It's very famous, many of us know his story. Malik ibn Dinar. If you were to study the life of this tabi'i, you will find one thing very amazing, that one, you cannot make an assessment or be judgmental or some of someone's lifestyle, because we do not know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has in store for that person. Malik ibn Dinar was a man who lived in disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Was a Muslim, believer. He prayed salat like me and you. But he was very oppressive and he was very consumed a lot of alcohol. who was living a life of sin. Until he got a dream, and that dream changed his life. He dreamt one night, if I had to go back before that, his wife died at a very early age, and he was left with one daughter. She got sick, and she died between the age of 2 or 3. And then that young girl, she saw at that age how her father was consuming alcohol. She would take those bottles and she would bring them herself, even at that young age. After the death of this child, he got consumed. He went into depression, as we might say today. And he started to consume a lot of alcohol. And became more distracted in terms of deed. Like many of us, we are good until we have problems. And as believers, when we have difficulties and Allah tests us, that is the time we should exhibit the level of our iman. The level of one iman is not when everything is going smooth. MashaAllah, he's a good Muslim. He's got good health, good strength, good job, good business, good family. No. It is how you react when Allah decides to test you. In this case, Malik ibn Dinar went into depression and he became an alcoholic. So he stopped frequenting the masjid. So one night he had a dream. There's a huge serpent or a huge monster or a snake was chasing him. And he was running until he reached an old feeble man and he stopped and he begged the man for help. And the man said, "I cannot help you. I am too old. This beast or this snake is too huge. I don't have the strength to fight it." Until he reached a cliff. And he saw some children. And among those children, he saw his daughter. And he said, "What are you doing here, my daughter?" She said, "This is the garden that Allah has kept all the children that passed away, they are thrown in this garden." So he told her of the incident, and he told her this beast is chasing him. So after telling her the story, he asked her to explain what happened. She said, "Oh my father, this beast or this monster is your evil deeds. Is overtaking you. And this old feeble man is your good deeds. You have so little, it cannot save you, it cannot protect you." So then he woke up and he made such a repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why I say in the beginning, you cannot judge someone from their lifestyle or the way they live or the sin they commit. Malik ibn Dinar became a muhaddith, a great scholar of hadith. He had written books on hadith literature. He had great following in his time. It is said his grave was found in India, in Kerala. One thing that caused Malik ibn Dinar not to forget his purpose of life and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is his father. His father was a very poor man from Afghanistan, who raised him to be a very good young man. But one thing his father instilled in him, and this is what I want all of us to understand, is the power of love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That love that his father instilled in him stayed with him throughout his life. And that was the love, the seed that was sown that changed his life. How many of us here, we are once living in life of sin, meaning that we were not praying our salat, we were not coming to the masjid. And then we reflect and we ponder on the advice of other people, maybe our father, maybe our mother. And when we were young, and very aggressive, and very rebellious, and they were telling us to change our life, and we did not change, we ignored them. Then as we grow old, we learn the love that they instill in our hearts, surface and became strong. And that love is something that kept us in deen. We live in a society where discipline is different than the place we came from. Many of us, we came from a background where discipline, most at the time, was being physical. Maybe our mother, maybe our father used to be physical with us to pray our salat or to fast from Allah or to do good things or to go to the masjid. But we live in a society where those things cannot be applicable. So we have to devise means and ways where we can instill love in the hearts of our children, that even though they might be rebellious and disobedient, eventually that love will blossom to the fruits one day, inshallah. The love for the deen that we instill in our children is like the root of a tree. So long the root is strong, the tree will always have fruits. But if the root is weak, disease will overtake it and it will die. It will not grow. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not question us if our children pray or not. No man will be accountable if your children are disobedient to Allah and you advise them. You are only accountable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you did not give your children knowledge of haram and halal, a knowledge of deen, a love for deen. That is what we will be accountable for. Allah will not ask us, you know what? Did your child pray salah? Did you make your child pray salah? Oh Allah, I did my job. I advised them. I teach them Quran. I advise them to make 5 salawat, whether they pray one, whether they pray two. As they grow up to be men of adulthood and women, they will be accountable for their own deeds. We must understand this as Muslims, that Allah will not judge us based on results. No prophet of Allah, no Muslim, will be accountable for results. We will be accountable for the effort we make. I live in this community. What effort did I make to instill love for deen, love for Allah in the hearts of my children, my family, and the members of this community?
be my accountability. That would be my hisab. Did I do my job? When interacting with all of the Muslims in our workplace, our co-workers, our neighbors, our friends, how did we exemplify Islam to them? Did they, through our examples, love Islam? Or were they attracted to Islam based on my lifestyle? Or on the other hand, did they become people who were aggressively towards Muslim or dislike Islam and dislike Muslim because of my interaction, because of my ways? Because I am a tough and rude and harsh Muslim. And I was very aggressive to tell them that it is either Islam or nothing else. Many of us, we became enemies towards our own family members and our children because we did not use hikmah in giving them the message of Islam. We created more enemies than friends. Rather, it should be the opposite. And I will tell you why. Why we create enemies and friends? Because we want to see results. Results is not in my hands, nor in your hands. Result is not in the hands of the prophets. It was never in the hands of the prophets. Allah would not question the prophets. How come your people did not accept Islam? Allah will question the prophets on the effort they have made towards the people, towards the power, towards the nation. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will not be hold accountability because his grandfather did not accept Islam. He gave the da'wah and the message to his grandfather on his dying bed. Oh my grandfather, if you will accept Islam. And this recite this phrase, La ilaha illallah, I Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will stand in front of Allah in the court of justice on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah and plead for your behalf. This was the duty of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Today, we wage war and we fight and we kill because we want to see results. And we want results very quickly. Very quickly. We want to establish Islam on the earth like yesterday. Allah will not question us, my dear brothers and sisters. How many people did you kill because they refused to say La ilaha illallah? No man will stand in front of Allah and Allah will question, why did you not tell the people about Islam? Why did you not convert this whole America and make them Muslim? Allah will say, because of your action, did you portray deen to these people? Did you instill love for deen in the hearts of your children? Today we are very harsh towards our children. Malik did not have that love that his father instilled in his heart for deen, even though he was an alcoholic. Even though he went astray, he came back on deen because of the love that was instilled in his heart. Very important. This love for deen is a very powerful thing, my dear brothers and sisters. You know when you love someone dearly in your heart, even though that person died and went away for a long time, that seed of love is still in your heart alive. It could be your mother, it could be your father, it could be your grandfather, your grandmother, it could be your daughter, it could be your son, it could be your brother, your sister.
No matter if the pastor in 10 years or 20 years, that love is still in your heart. You know, once, and I'm telling you about President's situation, a mother has one son, and she is still being in this boy's life. She did her job as a mother. But it so happened when this young man grew up, he fell in love with a non-Muslim girl. Many of us, we have this problem. That is why in the old times, the old generation, the people who used to marry when they were 14 or 15, my grandfather used to say, you marry your children before they fall in love, because if they do fall in love, they will fall in love with the wrong person. And that is what happened to this boy. He fell in love with the non-Muslim girl. In those days, if they marry, then they fall in love. But a lot of those marriage works. Today we cannot tell the younger generation that they don't want to hear those things. And many of them, they make a lot of mistakes. In a few years, marriage break up. So many problems in our society. Muslim in our society, in this community, think of it as our community, our families. There are more divorced than we had 10 years ago. We are becoming very competitive with the other denominations in divorces. Anyway, this young man fell in love with a girl, and he told me to marry her, even though she's a non-Muslim. His mother pleaded with him, and she cried. She cried. He eventually married, and he went to live on his own. But his mother gave him one thing as a present. And she said to him, my son, I'm giving you a Quran. Put it on your shelf, even though you may not need it or read it. Because now you have formed an allegiance with someone who don't love Allah, don't love Rasulullah, don't love Islam. Then your values will be diminished. Your heart will not be attached to Allah. And so many things, you know. But he said, every time you look at this Quran, always remember one thing, that Allah loves you. Every time you look at this Quran, know that Allah loves you. And as I said before, Allah does not love you when He gives you wealth. Because Allah gives wealth to whom He loves and those in whom He does not love. He gives wealth to non-Muslims and Muslims. But when Allah truly loves someone, He gives him iman. And that iman is priceless. Even if your children does not pray, or does not fast, but they have iman, it is a sign that Allah loves them. When that iman is removed from their hearts, that is when they become ungrateful. Allah takes away iman. May Allah protect our children, inshallah, all of us for that. That is why we always bring this dua, O Allah, we live and die with iman, inshallah. O Allah, make me live and die with iman. Because death without iman, you die as a bankrupt person. You die the most poorest person. You can die a millionaire, but without iman, in the sense of Allah, you are the poorest, you are a beggar, a faqir. So you pray for your children that they have iman at least. But do not push them to that limit where they will give up iman because of your hostility and your harshness towards them. Always try to preserve iman in their heart. At least even though they, your eyes are closed along the road, maybe they might live to see 60, 70 years,
Then they will realize my father was right. And then they will turn to Islam. And then they will pray Salat. That is what you want. You want them to realize the value of Iman. Love for Allah, love for this deen. We are not teaching our children love for Allah, love for this deen. And if you don't know the value of something, you don't love it. If you don't know the value of something, you don't love it. You give a 5-year-old child a diamond ring. The child will take the ring and they will play it like a toy. A ring that is probably valued thousands of dollars. But you give someone who knows the value, be careful, it's gone. As you know the value, you become attached to it. You preserve it. You don't know the value of deen, you don't know the value of iman, then you do not preserve it. You don't make effort to preserve it. So this young man went ahead and married this Muslim girl. And his mother gave him this Quran, and he put it on the shelf. And he started living his life. Eventually his mother passed away. And his wife bare a child. When this child was around 2 or 3 years old, he realized one thing. He realized that now this child has to grow with some identity. Whether this child is a Christian, whether this child is a Muslim, what is the identity of this child? And he started teaching this child Surah Al-Fatiha. Alhamdulillah. His wife became very angry because bear in mind she was not a Muslim. He went against his parents and married his girl. And one day he sat at his chair and looked at the Quran that his mother gave him and tears came from his eyes. Because after so many years passed and his mother passed away, he realized what mistake he has made. But one thing, the seed that the mother sowed in his heart, love for Allah, love for this deen, he began to change his life. He began to change his life. His mother gave him an advice before she left this world. And he remembered those advice that, oh my son, you will have problems in life because of the mistake you have made. You know, many of us, we were not practicing Muslim when we were young. As we started to practice Islam, our children became older and they got married. I met a father who has 3 kids. He's almost 80 years old. And every time I talk to him, he cried. Because none of his children actually are considered Muslims. None of his children are considered Muslims. When he was young, when he got married, he was living a life, being a real American life, as it was. Partying, having a nice time. No time for Allah, no time for wisdom. Then Allah gave him, he died. Then now he knows the value of Iman. Then he knows what will happen when you don't pray your Salat. Then he knows what will happen to you if you die without Iman. Then now he's depressed because of his children condition. But then that age has passed. He's become old. He's now in the cover. He's going. What will this concern be? He did not sow the seed of love for deen in the hearts of his children. May Allah give us tawfiq, inshallah, that we'll be able to sow.
sow the seed of love for these and our children and each other. May Allah protect our generation and help us that no matter what the consequences, they do not give up iman, inshallah. Always work to preserve iman in your heart, in my heart, and in the hearts of the people whom we love and whom we concern about. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم واستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا مولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم. Well, I think we're right after this.